and then I open a hatch by using a lighter to melt wax to a horseshoe, which is the most LucasArts point and click this game has been so far. So I find where the remote is, but I'm blocked by Webby, who says I need a key. So is this like a LucasArts point and click game now? Then back to the flower shop owner, then back to the tree. Because we're in a LucasArts point and click game now, apparently. Oh hey look, it's a LucasArts point and click game! This is Brand New Relic, the monthly series where I finally play the classic games I never got to try. When I say LucasArts, you might think of this.
I am your father.
Or this. Or this.
This is the way.
This is the way.
Or sometimes even this.
Now this is pod racing.
But you'd be wrong, because that's Lucasfilm. LucasArts was the video game wing, and for almost 30 years they were quite prolific, starting with the unfortunately named Ball Blazer in 1984. They became known for their point-and-click adventure games, many of which have gone on to be considered some of the greatest titles ever made, including one of my all-time favorites, Grim Fandango. But if there's one franchise that LucasArts is known for, I mean, it's Star Wars. But if there are two franchises that LucasArts is known for, then it's Monkey Island. There were 5 Monkey Island games in total, released between 1990 and 2009, and there were even plans for a movie at one point. It was synonymous with LucasArts until the company was absorbed by Disney in 2013. As all companies are, and as all companies eventually will be. So let's journey all the way back to 1990 and play the best video game of the year that wasn't called Super Mario Bros. 3. I know that The Secret of Monkey Island is about pirates, and that it's a point-and-click game, which means that I point at things, and then click on them. And I know that much like many of the adventure games that came out of LucasArts, it's known for its narrative, its sense of humor, and its bizarre puzzles. And I know that it was co-created by Tim Schafer, who I was once in the same room as. Yes, you should be jealous of me. I was right there. So let's not waste any more time, there's adventure to be had. Yes, I'm playing the Special Edition, which gives you the option of remastered graphics and additional voice acting, but I'm keeping it to the original version. So we're on Melee Island, where this dude named Guybrush Threepwood tells this other dude that he wants to be a pirate. I don't know why Guybrush is here, why he wants to be a pirate, or who this other guy is, but who cares? It's time for part one, the three trials. I go to the Scum Bar, and yeah, I've seen some bars like this in Philly. And wow, this artwork is genuinely great, especially for 1990. I learn that the feared pirate captain LeChuck died in a storm, and I'm treated to the first of many trademark jokes. This pirate takes some time to plug another LucasArts game, and I can even talk to the dog! I chat with some important-looking pirates, seriously, that's what they're called, and they tell me that to be a pirate I have to master swordplay, thievery, and treasure hunting.
Meanwhile!
In the lava-filled underground of Monkey Island, the ghost of LeChuck is still LeChucking along. And the main villain's already heard of me? Word travels fast on Melee Island. I meet a map seller, an unfortunate and outdated trope, and the town's cantankerous sheriff. Oh, is it already 11 o'clock? I try to steal a sword, but I still haven't quite mastered thievery. One step at a time, I guess. I meet a pirate who wants me to break him out of jail, and I'm here for these pirate-themed dad jokes. I end up stealing a lot of things, you know, like a pirate would. And nice cameo, Pillsbury Doughboy. I dip some meat in a pot, and no, that's not a euphemism. And now I don't know where to go, so I'm going to have to stew on this for a while. The jokes are rubbing off on me. Tim Schafer, I'm waiting for your call. It turns out I can explore all of Melee Island. And by all, I mean like 6 places. And sure, just a random circus in the middle of the forest on a remote island. Nothing sketchy about that. I get shot out of a cannon, meet a troll guarding a bridge.
What is the airspeed velocity of an unladen swallow?
I break the fourth wall, not that it needs much help getting broken, and I break into the governor's mansion in order to steal an idol.
That belongs in a museum!
I have the most epic battle. Off-screen. But I get the idol, and then I meet the governor, Elaine Marley, and yeah, I'd be tongue-tied too. Especially that brief change in expression when she says your face is sweet. These artists really brought their A-game when putting this one together. But the sheriff has other plans. He throws me into the drink, and I have no idea how I'm going to get out of this. Oh. Well, that wasn't so hard. Hey, that's what I said! So one trial down, I'm a master thief now. And this romance is so sudden. It would never work, Guybrush. She's a governor. You're a pirate. She's a slave to duty, like a Gilbert and Sullivan show. Or an Aaron Sorkin show about people who are obsessed with Gilbert and Sullivan. I torture a bird so that I can give the troll a red herring and oh, I get it. Yeah, that's a good one. I meet the love child of Guile and Sagat, who teaches me swordplay. But because it's a point-and-click game, the swordplay is done through insults, and this is such a unique and enjoyable mechanic. You have to find the appropriate retort to every insult. Turns out so's your mother is never the answer, which feels unrealistic. And the only way you can learn all the proper retorts is by fighting a bunch of pirates and remembering what they say. So now I'm ready for the Swordmaster. I engage in some light stalking in order to find her, I defeat her in battle, and all I got was this lousy t-shirt. So two trials down, and all that's left is treasure hunting. But the map that I bought is just a dance lesson. Or is it? Turns out it's directions to get through the forest. It's also a dance lesson, though. And sure enough, X marks the spot. It's amazing how many hours have passed and it's still nighttime. I get to the treasure and it's just a t-shirt? At least it wasn't knowledge. And that ghost ship isn't creepy at all. Turns out the governor was kidnapped by LeChuck, because of course she was. He's taken her to Monkey Island, so in order to save her, I need a ship and a crew.
Meanwhile...
Wait, the sheriff's on this ship? Then that would mean...
What?
I knew there was something unusual about him. Mainly because the game kept pushing that there was something unusual about him. So now it's time to get a crew together. Wait, several hours have passed and it's still just 11 o'clock? And yeah, I don't want circus folk in my crew, good call there. But the Swordmaster is game. And wow, seizure warning please. So I don't want to take any of the voodoo stuff, but I'm perfectly fine taking a rubber chicken with a pulley on it. Okay. But that allows me to get to this Candyman cosplayer here. To prove my bravery, he has me face off against a parrot. So okay, great, he's on my crew. And apparently he can swab my decks anytime. I use the grog from the bar to melt the locks in the jail to free the prisoner. So is the grog really just Mountain Dew Baja Blast? And the prisoner maybe joins my crew? Maybe? So now to get a ship, I need to get a line of credit, as this arm-flailing, Shakespeare-quoting, teleporting salesman can attest. So I try to get a line of credit, but I get denied. Wow, it's amazing how close this game is to real life. And then I just steal a line of credit. Somewhere, Bernie Sanders is smiling. I do a better job negotiating the price of the ship with this salesman than I did negotiating the actual price of my actual car. And yikes, the misogyny of this guy.
Louis, I think this is the beginning of a beautiful...
Wait, what? But you sold me this ship, Farron! Oh, okay, never mind. So I have my ship, I have my crew, looks like we're ready to go to part two! And it's nice to see the crew working so hard. Meanwhile, I'm just up here, with my thoughts. And hey, this ship has a lot of Cap'n Crunch. No oops all berries. I make a stew so strong that it knocks me unconscious. And when I wake up, I'm at Monkey Island. And you can't swim? Then why on earth do you want to be a pirate, Guybrush? There's no lifeboat, so I shoot myself out of the cannon, and we're in part three. I explore the map of the island.
This is crack.
And yes, weird hermit, this is a nice view. Okay, bye. I use a rock catapult to... Did I just... murder my crew? Shish Kebab. Shishka Joe. Shishka Larry. This game is great. And that giant monkey head looks fun. Oh, hey, buddy. How about this heat, huh? And what pressing business does this hermit have that makes him say he? You know what? I'm making the decision to not want to know. I blow up a dam, take a thing off a dead guy, and now I can row my boat. Life is but a dream. And wow, this cannibal tribe trope has certainly not aged well. But they're avoiding red meat, just like me. I get a monkey to follow me by giving it bananas. That checks out. Made by Red Skull. Wait, that Red Skull? Made by Sharptooth. Wait, that Sharptooth? The monkey helps me get into LeChuck's monkey head base. And Guybrush, you're not supposed to use a Q-tip for that purpose. So the giant monkey head leads to the lava-filled underground, obviously.
From my point of view, the Jedi are evil!
I don't know where I'm going, so the cannibal tribe gives me a navigating head and no, that's cool. I didn't need to sleep for a month. I put on an invisibility necklace and board the ghost ship. And looks like I found the root of the problem. Seriously, Tim Schafer, call me. I give it to the cannibals so they can make a ghost-killing device, and... Here's the fun thing about game design. They had to come up with that three-headed monkey idea, draw up some concept art, then make that asset, then give it several animations, then program the whole thing into the game. All for that brief moment. That's hours of work right there. Just for that one bit. Amazing. I go back to the ship, but it's gone. LeChuck and Governor Marley are set to be married on Melee Island, and I haven't even looked at their registry yet. So we're at the last part as I head back to Melee and start taking out ghosts left and right.
We came, we saw, we kicked its ass!
And wait, it's still 11 o'clock? I run to the church to stop the wedding. And then I bravely rescue the... Oh. Never mind. Looks like she didn't need saving. Awesome. Oh, those crazy monkeys with their secrets and their islands and I don't know what. Well, this plan certainly isn't working out the way I thought it would. I get knocked down, but I... No, you know what? What if I didn't get up again? After all, I've been through a lot. What if I didn't do anything and just stayed like this forever? What would happen then? Oh, okay, fine. I defeat LeChuck, who explodes into a fantastic display of fireworks, and then I reunite with the governor and we watch the display together. Oh, and my former crew is in cannibal jail, apparently. And that's it. That's the secret of Monkey Island. Wait, Orson Scott Card worked on this? And wait, James Woods worked on this? Oh, no, different person. And then the game tells me to turn off the computer and go to sleep. I mean, it's 1 in the afternoon, but okay, who am I to argue it? Bye. This was so much fun. The artwork is vibrant and colorful and strikes that difficult balance between detailed and cartoonish. Apart from some of the random pirates you fight, no two assets were alike. It made the world feel rich and full. Did you hear that, Call of Duty? And that detail extends to its excellent humor. From the way text appears upside down after being launched from a cannon, to the hilarious actions during the epic off-screen battle, there must have been so much talk about the mood and aesthetic of this world, and they absolutely nail it. In terms of gameplay, I mean, the only way to lose is not to play. No way to die, no way to get a game over, it's all about solving problems. And there are a lot of really great ideas here, such as swordplay through insults, and some of the puzzles that you solve are really fun. Some. So it feels weird to talk about this, since vague puzzles with obscure solutions are the bread and butter of this kind of game. But some of these puzzles were vague, and had obscure solutions. There were some great aha moments in the game, like with the rock catapult, while others, such as using a magnet and your compass to get a key, are so out of left field that they're almost impossible to figure out. The special edition has a generous hint system for when you get stuck, but even that doesn't help when essential items are hidden in places that aren't even labeled on the map. It's a pretty short game, so I imagine the difficulty helps pad the game time, but it makes some of those solutions feel less aha and more seriously? And while the game is very funny, the story is rather slight. It doesn't take any of its characters or relationships very seriously, which, you know, makes it hard for me to care about the characters and relationships. It was a similar issue I had with Earthbound earlier in the season. Compare that with Grim Fandango, which manages to be really funny while also being very sincere. There's definitely a way to balance the two. I mean, Undertale literally winks at the audience while pulling on your heartstrings. But because Monkey Island is nothing but sardonic, it makes the whole thing feel... kind of inconsequential. Which is a shame because it undermines some really great narrative moments. Governor Marley having her own much superior plan for escape is such a great idea that could have expanded on her character and her relationship to Guybrush. Instead, it's just another joke. Also, my guess is not much has been written about the music and sound because, you know, there's not much of it. However, this gave me similar vibes to when I played Katamari Damacy. It was short, it was sweet, it was well made, it makes me want to play the sequels, and like Grim Fandango, I have no doubt I'll be picking this one up again. More importantly though, this is the 12th and final episode of Season 1. So, let's take a moment to recap. Ranking things via tiers are all the rage right now, so why not jump on that bandwagon? The series started out in September with Final Fantasy VII. While I had a lot of complaints about the game at the time, it keeps sticking in my brain. I really did enjoy this one quite a bit. At the time I was feeling B tier, but now, it's an A. For Halloween, I played Silent Hill 2. Silent Hill starts with S, and this is pure S tier. This game is far and away my favorite discovery in the series so far. Super creepy, super tense, great story, great atmosphere, great gameplay, great everything. Earthbound was next, and while I enjoyed its humor and creativity, the wildly unbalanced difficulty level kept getting in the way for me. So this one's getting a C. Super Mario Galaxy 2 closed out the calendar year, and while there was a lot to love, it just didn't stack up to some of my favorite Mario titles, and certainly doesn't live in my head rent-free the way Super Mario Bros. 3 or Super Mario Odyssey does. It's clearly not a popular opinion, seeing as it's the only video in the series so far to receive downvotes, but I'm going C tier on this one. A new year brought us Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic. Star Wars starts with S, and this is pure S tier. This game is nearly flawless, and was one of my favorite episodes to make, despite all the stuttering issues I had with OBS. But those issues were fixed with February's Doom episode, along with a new title sequence and a new theme song, courtesy of Philadelphia's own Liz Filios. I was surprised how well Doom and its sequel held up over the years, despite not really being my kind of aesthetic. So Doom and Doom 2 land firmly in the B tier. March started my first miniseries, going through three generations of PlayStation games, and it got off to a literally rocky start with Tomb Raider, a long, laborious title that despite being hugely influential has not held up very well. I hate to do it, Lara, but your first title is D tier. PlayStation 2 gave us Katamari Damacy, which, oh wow, what a treat. It's not a big game, it's not a complex game, but what it does oh so very well. Definitely A tier. I closed out the miniseries with PlayStation 3's iconic Call of Duty 4 Modern Warfare, and this one tore me apart. Like James Dean, its design across the board was absolutely S tier, while its story, which basically boiled down to kill a bunch of Middle Easterners, was F tier. So this lands somewhere in the C range. Then in June, I went way back with the NES title DuckTales, which definitely earns its status as an iconic title, despite its short length. A tier on this one. Pokemon Crystal finally got me to play through a Pokemon title, and despite feeling rather slight, at the end of the day I had a good time with this one. B tier all the way. Which leaves The Secret of Monkey Island. Secret of Monkey Island begins with S, and this is not pure S tier. As mentioned earlier, it's a fun game that feels somewhat inconsequential, so it lands right in that good old B tier. So after 12 games in 12 months, this feels like a good balance. Some games I absolutely loved, some I was less of a fan of, but with each and every one I figured out what all the hype was about, and I was grateful to be given the ability to play through them. That, of course, couldn't have happened without all of you who supported me. Whether it was signing up for my Patreon, donating consoles and games, or simply watching the episodes, you helped make this season. I produced 12 episodes, got my first You're Bad at Gaming comment, and had over 700 views, which isn't a lot, but it's 700 views I didn't have before. I'm gonna be taking a little break, but no, not like that, and that's not even what I look like. I'm taking the rest of the year to focus on some big life plans and to work on my next game, but I'll be back with Season 2. Since I started my first season with Final Fantasy VII, it only makes sense that I begin my second with Final Fantasy VI. I know, it doesn't make much sense, but when has that ever stopped me? So until then, and I truly mean this, thank you so much for watching.